talk about how I have thought about in some of my work about issues of gender, masculinities, and sexualities. My most recent book is actually about the city, and that's the one thing that doesn't have masculinity and sexuality in the title. Although it is about some of the work is about gender and space. What I want to do here is to, I will not read all of it, I'll read little bits and pieces and then talk to my paper. It's both an attempt to be historical about the idea of gender and sexuality, but also partly ethnographic. And I'll begin with the kind of opening decades of the 20th century, and then towards the end come to the present, by which I mean the last few years, in relation to a specific event which has to do with masculine cultures in India. And partly it's an attempt to really think about not a unilinear history and how one could try and think about gender, but how one might begin with certain sets of ideas and look at how these ideas recur in the present, right? And that's what I'll end with. So let me begin with to give you, and most of my work is not really I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing, it's not particularly focused on one particular topic. I've never really worked on one particular topic. My first work was on schooling, on a boys' school, a boarding school, which I was interested in the masculinity and space, and then I worked on sexuality and then the city. So, and a lot of this, you'll see some of this perhaps reflected here. Some of you perhaps may find it a bit scattered and unfocused. But then I think if you're trying to think about the present, if you're trying to think about the present as a student of the present, and if you think you've actually grasped the essence of the present, then come and let me know, because I don't have any idea about how you grasp the essence of the present, right? Okay. So let me begin with the opening decades of the 20th century before I come to the present. So I'll go through different kind of decades. Not an attempt to give you a unilinear history, but then to come back in the present to how the past comes back and stays with us. So, in the opening decades of the 20th century, there's a large body of what's referred to as sexological literature. There were people in Maharashtra writing about it. There was a very famous American someone who's known as a pioneer birth controller, very important part of the birth control movement, called Margaret Sanger. Margaret Sanger came to India, she spoke to Gandhi about birth control, he wasn't very happy about it. In Maharashtra in particular, you know, there was a big sexology movement. There were very famous books which were circulating all over Maharashtra. There was a book called, published in 1927 by a professor of mental and moral philosophy who taught in Kolhapur, Maharashtra. It was called Sex Problem in India, Being a Plea for a Eugenic Movement in India and a Study of All Theoretical and Practical Questions Pertaining to Eugenics. So my title actually not that long compared to this one. Eugenics you've heard of, right? Eugenics, that particular so-called science of genetics that seeks to produce so-called particular kinds of human beings, right? So in the opening decades of the 20th century, there's a very big, a particular kind of sexology movement, particularly in Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu. And a lot of this was actually linked to the ideas of people could see that in a few decades, India was going to be an independent country. And then it became linked to many ideas about how do you produce a population that is apparently fit to be a free population, right? And a lot of this became linked to ideas of eugenics. They became linked to ideas of science and how science can produce particular kinds of free populations that is suitable to occupy a free nation. So, for example, this book that I just told you about, the author was someone called N.S. Farke. He said that his discussion was concerned with the issue of how to maintain the vigor of a declining race. And there have been long these arguments about how India declined because there was Muslim rule and various other foreign influences, and how do you reinvigorate a declining race? A very significant aspect of a lot of sexological literature was what Parike, for example, referred to in his book as sexual swaraj. He actually used that term, like swaraj, you know. Yeah? So while swaraj was a political term, there's also another context that we don't often think about, which had to do with sexuality. in the Indian context. And people are taking quite seriously, you know, how, what is good sexuality? How do you produce good relationships? How will this lead into reducing a population of a free nation state? And the other thing you should think about is that we think of Indian influences being mostly from the West. A very significant part of this was the a very big sexological science movement from the erstwhile USSR, right? Because the erstwhile USSR had a very big, because the whole idea of the ideal worker, how do you produce the ideal worker, had to do a lot with relying on science because of the Marxist legacy and scientific materialism. So a lot of these ideas were not necessarily only coming from the US and the UK, of course they were, but also from the erstwhile USSR. Okay. Now, the other thing I want to just, before I move on from here, is that a lot of this is also related to caste. You have to also remember that the opening decades, the last few decades of the 19th century and the opening decades of the 20th century also had lots of anti-caste movements, right? So a lot of this sexology movement, and so I'm trying to point to the different kind of directions that one can take this discussion to, had to do with caste. Now, let me read you an excerpt from this book by Ennis Folke, right, which is about eugenics, plea for eugenic movement in India. He said, it need never be supposed, that the ancient Aryans were ignorant of the first principle of eugenics and that India will have to learn them anew at the feet of Western scholars. For even in the Vedic and Puranic times, Folke says, our ancestors had realized the value of eugenic principles with remarkable fullness of vision and depth of anxious insight, and how they had applied them to social laws and customs with conspicuous skills and foresight, etc., etc. So here what happens is that sexology and whole notion of caste become deeply interlinked. And people were saying that, you know, the caste system was good because eugenics proves that in fact eugenics is something that can tell you that the caste system was according to scientific principles, that you are choosing who you marry, who you have children with, and hence that science can tell you that the caste system was good. And you have to remember that the background of this was also the deep anxiety amongst upper caste people about the anti-caste movements, right? Okay, so this then became the larger context about a certain kind of sexual culture linked with caste and a certain kind of sexual culture with also linked with masculinities. Because, of course, a great deal of public discourse is about men, right? So how do you produce the perfect citizen? And by default, we know historically the idea of citizenship is also about what, say, political philosophers refer to as the fraternal contract, fraternal in that literal sense of men. Fraternity, okay? Okay. So, now, Folke wasn't the only one who was doing Kandigal. There was a very big movement. So, for example, there was a very famous, and now long forgotten, but a very significant man from Maharashtra, who came to settle in Maharashtra, called A.P. Pillai. Now, you all heard the Family Planning Association of India, right? A.P. Pillai was one of the founders of Family Planning Association of India. He wrote a book called The Art of Love and Sane Sex Living, published in 1948, which was very popular. And these kind of histories are not necessarily, you know, we don't necessarily think of these kind of histories as the obvious kind of histories we should look at. So what happens in this particular period is this play of the connection between caste, sexuality, sexology, and the ideal middle-class family, which was to then occupy the post-colonial nation state. And how do you produce it, okay? So here, sexology is no thing of itself, right? So sexology is not, academically or in terms of scholarship interest in sexology, it's not really about how, what happens between two people, right? It's only interesting if you can position it in terms of what happens in terms of wider social processes of power, most significantly. Okay, so there are all these kind of things happening in the opening decades of the 20th century. It's often said, now one of the things that you'll hear very often discussed if you read about sexuality studies and sexology in India is the whole idea of what is referred to by psychologists and anthropologists also as the semen anxiety complex. You've heard of semen anxiety,
yeah.
Right? And that's, I mean, it's good as far as it goes, but actually semen anxiety was as big as the 19th century in England as it was in India. If you read a lot of material, that there were similar kinds of things being expressed. What I want to now move on to is the idea of the fact that you actually cannot understand ideas of sexuality and masculine India through this notion of semen anxiety. Semen anxiety, you know what it is? Is anyone bold enough to tell me what semen anxiety is? No one, obviously. I have to do the job. No, semen anxiety is the idea that the semen is the core of masculinity, and that any non-reproductive waste of semen anxiety is a lessening of masculine self. Okay, that's basically it. In Hindi, a lot of psychologists use it. In Hindi, it also has a name in psychological literature in India. It's known as the Dhat syndrome. Dhat is the essence. Huh? Okay. So I want to now move on to another context. Having given you this kind of very sketchy introduction to what was happening in the opening decades of the 20th century in terms of sexology in very significant parts of India, let's just put up the first. Okay, I'm not going to go into this, but I want to tell you that we should always think of masculinity as having a history. Okay, there's no such thing as instant masculinity. Do you know what martial races are? Any ideas? So martial race is this idea that comes about after 1857 when the British decide to reorganize the army according to who they think are people who are particularly martial, you know, particularly warlike, and people who are not. So as you would expect, the group that comes to be, that was perhaps seen to be most hostile to the British and comes to be, get identified as non-martial, were Bengalis, right? Okay. And the other groups like Gurkhas and Sikhs come to get identified as martial. And so historically, then people, we are what discourses make us, right? So historically, people do come to engender, adopt the idea of martial races. And to this day, you have large numbers of people, ethnic communities, who trace their history in terms of their warlike attributes, apparently. You know, I used to be part of this fellowship scheme for South Asia, run by the Social Science Research Council in the US. And you get people from Pakistan, India, who apply for fellowships, right? And so we have a lot of people from a lot of Pashtuns, huh? And as part of this fellowship, they would have to do these projects. Huh? So all our Pashtun fellows with a capital F, who got these fellowships, that most of the fellowship they wanted to do was about poetry. Right? We have no sense that Pashtuns are anything but martial races, right? And they would say, you know, we have poetry, we have songs. All you think of us are people who hold guns and kill people. Right? So there is a history to how masculinity is created. That's what I want to say by putting up this particular picture. And I'll come back to some of these ideas. So I wanted to just introduce the idea of martial races. Now, let me now just move from this idea I've given you to the whole idea of scientific masculinity and sexuality in the opening decades of the 20th century, to what happens then slightly later in the 40s and 50s, before I come to my present. Here I want to introduce to you the idea of what I want to refer to as, and unfortunately I'm missing the slide because I got a bit mixed up with other things. So I'm moving now to scientific masculinity, scientific sexuality, to another, what happens to the post-independence era. Here I want to introduce to you another model of masculinity that I'd like to refer to as the five-year plan hero. Do you know what the five-year plans were? You know, I mean, most of you, right? So before the Niti Aayog became Niti Aayog, it was the Planning Commission. So I want to now introduce to you a particular application of science, masculinity, and the linkages of sexuality in the post-colonial period. And I had some images here of whom I thought I could represent as five-year plan heroes. Now, so how do the discourses of science and rationality, what role do they play in the life of the modernizing post-colonial modernizing state? Clearly, science, as various people have discussed, was a very significant aspect of how people defined, in the Indian context, identity. You know, science wasn't something also we only did in laboratories. Science was something that also identified you as a particular kind of person because you were not thought of as being scientific enough, right? One part of colonialism was that these people are not scientific enough. They're too irrational, too emotional, too religious, etc., and else don't deserve self-rule. Huh? Okay. So the post-colonial state, science is a very significant aspect of how a modernizing elite saw itself as wanting to be represented. I don't know if you have been to Dehradun, if you've been to the campus of the Dune School, you know, the Dune School was established on the campus of what was earlier the Forest Research Institute. And the Forest Research Institute was largely a laboratory, right? So it was actually a series of laboratories that looked at trees and gardens, etc. And the idea very much was for the Indian middle class that established the Dune School to represent modern Indians as very closely linked to science. Okay? So I want to now move on to how this plays out in popular culture in the 50s and 60s through my idea of this five-year plan hero. And the classic five-year plan hero was someone, in fact, who was very instrumental was very, very strong influence in the five-year plans, someone called P.C. Mahalanobis. Mahalanobis was an economist and a statistician and a very significant influence on the early five-year plans. So here I want to combine trying to understand masculinity and masculine culture and sexual culture during that period with something and to bring together things that don't necessarily have to do with masculinity and sexuality. Can I look at the other next one? No, go back. I'll come back to this later. So yeah, in the middle, I'm missing the one that I wanted. Now, so what happened? So here I want to combine ideas of the economy, so-called economy, and society in order to break down that barrier between what we think is the economic and something we think is the social. The five-year plan hero in Indian filmic culture of 50s and 60s was a particular kind of person who represented a particular ideology of science and development theory. Okay, now, so the five-year plan hero, and I'll explain some of his characteristics then, represented a particular formulation of Indian masculinity where manliness came to attach not to bodily representations and aggressive physical behavior, that happens much later, but what you can think of as epistemological or science-based masculinity. So here I'm trying to gesture towards a particular kind of male hero that was present significantly throughout the 50s and 60s with a particular kind of background. He was an engineer, he was a doctor, he was an improver, he was a saver, he was heading out to the countryside in order to improve the countryside. Okay. So masculinity here in the 50s and 60s was never... If you look at all sort of black and white films, none of the men heroes are actually muscular. That happens much later. In fact, many of them actually what you would consider both quite portly, or even if you like to use that, quite camp in some way. You know, camp, right? In the sense that I'm putting these in inverted commas. Because masculinity was about the kind of person that hero was. That person was a scientist. That person was an engineer. That person was a doctor. That person headed out from the city to the countryside to improve the countryside. Yeah? So what happens in the post-colonial period in terms of the life of science is the transformation of science through development theory into particular models of masculinity, particular models of upper caste, middle class masculinity. And here caste also comes into play. As to why I think that the physical masculinity is not important, right? And how does caste come into play? Now, large numbers of heroes in black and white films, if you look at them, are actually, as I said, you know, they're not at all muscular in the same way that much later Salman Khan becomes a muscular figure. Because to be muscular is also to be lower caste, right? Because it also signifies working with your hands, okay? It is much later that muscularity becomes significant in masculinity because it becomes linked with global consumer culture, bodybuilding, the idea of your body becoming a commodity itself. Okay? But in that particular period, caste and science come together to produce, I think, very different ways of representing masculinity. And the five-year plan hero, who was very much someone who executed the five-year plans, was someone For in that context, I think, you know, like bodily masculinity would have been almost anathema because it would have undercut both the caste dimensions of masculinity, yeah, and it would also have not allowed the immediate post-colonial hero to be seen as a man of science, okay. Because that is indeed what was denied in the pre-colonial period, right? That scientists, that Indians couldn't be scientific and rational, etc., etc. Yeah. Okay. So the five-year plan hero was in different ways. He was scientific. He was rational. He occupied certain kinds of spaces. There's of course a huge discourse about how the village is such a significant part of Indian life in popular discourse, etc. But actually, if you look at large numbers of films, in the 50s and 60s up till about sort of mid 70s, it is the city that is the site of improving the rest of India. The village is a particular kind of place, but it's not the kind of place that where improvements happen. And it is the male improver who heads out into the countryside and then improves the city. So you also have the city as a male and the province as a female, right? So there are different ways in which masculinities, development theory, economic science can be analyzed through wider social context. So a number of films you may not have seen them, but if you're interested in, some of you may be interested in working on films, you'll find that, you know, there's a film called Sri Charso Beast, 1955, another one called Sujata in 1959, Anuradha in 1960. It's always where the hero is a metropolitan scientist, dam builder, engineer, etc., etc. Okay, so the other thing, of course, spatial strategies in the particular film. It is a city that is the home, the natural home of the 5-year plan hero, who I want to just repeat was his masculinity was an epistemological masculinity. It was a masculinity of the kind of discipline, the science. He was a scientist, right? So the 5-year plan hero is also someone. Which is dramatically different from now. The hero of the 1950s and 60s was someone who saved, right? The ideal man was someone who saved for the nation. The ideal male hero of the current period is the consumer, okay? Because it is consumption that links you to the globe, to the wider world, okay? Now, so his profession, his access to new knowledges of science, he was not asexual, but his sexuality was largely of a reproductive kind. And that's the other big difference in the masculinities now and masculinities then. Whereas contemporary sexuality of the male hero, and in some senses also women, the heroines, can be non-reproductive. Okay, so a significant aspect of 1950s and 60s male hero was the sexuality of the male hero was in the service of the nation. He was a father, he produced children for the nation, okay? And that is not true to the same extent now, okay? That has changed dramatically in some ways. So he was an economically and sexually frugal savior of the nation, who saved on behalf of the nation, okay? So this is some of the ways in which, the ideas of science, ideas of economic development, ideas of the city and spaces come into circulate as discourses in producing certain ideas of masculinity, certain ideas of sexuality through the 1950s and 60s. But you can see that by the end of the kind of sort of mid-70s, already by the end, by the sort of mid-60s, late 60s, this model is breaking down because certain kinds of heroes come into prominence who begin to break down this particular model, right? There are many heroes I could name of that particular era, but it really kind of breaks down in the mid-1970s with very one significant presence. Yes, I just heard someone saying.
Big B.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So what Amitabh Bachchan does is actually quite before that, of course, there were other heroes, but I don't think they have the same epoch-changing impact in terms of what happens to masculinity. So, in fact, if you, I don't know, Shami Kapoor, Jitendra were different kinds of male heroes at a particular period. They were not male. They were not 5-year plan heroes. They were not scientists. They were not land builders, not engineers, etc., etc. But what Amitabh Bachchan does is to bring into play a very specific kind of masculine hero, which breaks that. In very significant ways, the 5-year plan hero. And the 5-year plan hero is actually in many ways about saving, right? Saving for the nation, saving, being a reproductive person, not sex as leisure, but sex and service to the nation, yeah? Okay. Now, what in different ways Amitabh Bachchan does is to kind of break down that model. You know, many people say that Amitabh Bachchan's popularity when he was at the peak of his popularity has to do with his what some of the theories are about why Amitabh Bachchan was such a popular figure. Anyone? You all know Amitabh Bachchan? Anyone? No? Okay, one is that, you know, he represented a kind of anti-state figure, right? That he was vigilante figure, that people were tired of a state that didn't do anything, and he was someone who would take the law into his own hands, and then that was kind of a rise of a vigilante hero. I think that's interesting, but I don't think that, to me, explains the larger context of the popularity as a kind of male hero who breaks down the model of the five-year plan hero. How does he break it down? By different kinds of ways. See, one of the things that Amitabh Bachchan's masculinity also represents is the provincial hero who comes to the large city. Okay. Not the other way around. Okay. That's one. Number two, Amitabh Bachchan also, in many, I don't know if you've seen some of, in many of his films, when, you know, his masculinity is not necessarily built around an unambiguous heterosexual masculinity. And that is actually quite, in some of the sort of extra vignettes that you might some of the Amitabh Bachchan roles that he does, that a lot of his gestures, masculinity is not around him, unlike the five-year plan hero, which was an unambiguous heterosexual hero. Amitabh Bachchan's, some of his roles are actually about quite interesting kind of an ambiguous homoerotic aura that is around Amitabh Bachchan. So it is not enough for me to say that what explains Amitabh Bachchan's popularity is his sort of anti-state persona. He also represents the continuation that many of you, if you've lived in small towns, of our blurring a boundary between strict heterosexuality and other sexual cultures that continue to exist in many small towns. Like many of my friends who work in small towns in sexuality will often say that there are often no terms for non-heteronormative sexuality in small towns because it's not necessarily identified as such. It does get identified eventually because of, I know, as you come near to the metropolis, as is more and more NGO work, for example, right? So Amitabh Bachchan, when he, in many of his roles, also represents, in addition to his vigilante persona, that small town masculinity come to the city, a particular kind of ambiguous homoeroticism that is about his persona, where he's actually, the way he does some, you know, like some of his roles, cross-dressing, for example, some of his gestures when he does particular kind of hand claps, a particular kind of techniques of the body. So I don't know if you've seen Namak Halal and Dawn, where he really taps into an ambiguous sexual canvas in a manner which, if it was not, which was quite taboo for leading men before Amitabh Bachchan comes onto the scene, where, you know, the leading men were certainly men who that these kinds of the ways of representing the male body, the non-heterosexual male body, was really confined to kind of minor roles or character actors, not the hero itself. And in some ways, Amitabh Bachchan breaks that. He's also then, in this particular context, is the provincial man who comes to the city to, as quite distinct from the five-year plan hero, to become a consumer. Okay, he's not someone who's interested in sailing. If you look at his films, 70s and 80s, he's someone who moves among shipping containers. He's someone who looks at, I don't know, have you seen Dawn, anyone? Yeah. Okay. You know, very first scene where she looks at Helen's shoes and says shoes. I mean, these are very fancy shoes she's wearing. Okay. So what happens is that by the sort of 70s, this particular model of science, this particular model of the five-year plan hero, of the guy who does the sailing for the nation, is breaking down. Okay. That the hero is no longer necessarily the person who saves for the nation. The hero is increasingly, in this particular case, the consumer. So you already have someone coming to the city who wants to stake a claim as a consumer. So he's as much anti-statist in taking the law into his own hands, as well as announcing the beginning of a consumerist agenda. So the consumerist, now many people kind of say that the consumer culture we have now begins from 1991 when the new economic policy happens. But we need to kind of be perhaps a little bit more able to push back as in terms of larger popular culture as to when the rise of a new consumer culture comes about. Okay? Well, most of you are kind of many of you are, most of you are born into consumer culture, right? So you probably think that non-consumption is something peculiar. But certainly for my parents' generation, you know, the moral position was to not consume. And for many parents' generation, it was a moral position, right? That is why you have this entire culture of recycling amongst older people. It's not only kind of an economic position, actually a moral position. And that moral position begins to break down with Amitabh Bachchan. So he's this guy who comes from the province, from the city, occupies shanty towns, he's a consumer, there are shipping container terminals he moves around, there are shops he visits, there are things he wants to buy, he cannot buy, but he wants to have them, etc., etc. And there are various famous scenes. Now let me then move on to another kind of, next one. Okay, let's stop that. Now, what I want to do now, having introduced you to Amitabh Bachchan as the kind of first generation village, province dweller who comes to the city to become a part of the consuming cultures of the city, I want to now come to much more to the present. Although I'm sure none of you have ever seen or even read, right? Or would admit to. Okay. So, this section, I want to now introduce you to cultures of masculinity, sexuality. Now, this might now sound like a unilinear history, but I'll go back to suggesting why I think it's not unilinear, okay? And why some of these things, which are of the past apparently, are now with us now. How much time do I have?
About
20 minutes. Okay, 20 minutes, that's fine, good. So, this section is called Footpath Desires and Erotics of Modernity. So, part of my work earlier was, in Delhi, in fact, in this part of Haryana, of this part of the country, for example, they're also very popular, was to look at the people who visit sex clinics. Right? Why do they go to sex clinics? Who goes there? What kind of literatures are around sex clinics? What is the culture of sexuality around sex clinics? What do people read, etc., etc.? And so I'm borrowing now here, as I head towards the end of my talk, is to this idea of footpath desires and contemporary ideas of subaltern masculine and sexual cultures. Okay. Now, so the publication I want to now here draw upon some of my earlier work on publications I refer to as footpath pornography. Now, footpath pornography, maybe the next one as well. The next one as well. Footpath pornography refers to these cheaply produced booklets that you increasingly find less and less in larger cities, but they're still there in many small towns. They're cheap to acquire. The prices range from maybe 10 to 30 rupees. You can haggle over the prices. They're poorly printed. They're mostly available at these makeshift bookstalls that are around the bus stands and railway stations. The booklets are part of this complete world of circulation. You know, they're circulating. The people who buy them are constantly circulating. In as much as you buy them at a bus stand, you might be living in a slum or a shanty town, and you're constantly being moved out because that slum or shanty town is being cleared out. Right. So you buy them between catching a bus or a train, etc., etc. And what is also circulating, the publishers are also circulating. It's very difficult to go back and find the same publisher because he or she has moved on because there's been a police raid and never find them again. Just last week, someone from Outlook said to me, I want to interview some of these people, and most of these people have disappeared. So these kinds of booklets are part of the world of very mobile populations. Right? They themselves are very mobile, and they're part of the world of populations that are very, very mobile. And they're mostly certainly bought by young men. They may be read by young women as well. Large numbers of people who buy them live in shanty towns, slums, etc. They're part of this world of constant mobility. They have constant job losses. The government land policies change. They are evicted from the unauthorized places of settlement, etc., etc. Booklet photographs, booklet cover photographs often have European women or versions of Western-looking Indian women in poses of rapture and seduction. The authorship of these booklets is usually exclusively male. Okay. And I want to introduce these particular booklets in order to introduce you to a particular kind of sexual masculine culture, which is quite different from what was happening earlier, and also different in terms of the class context. So I want to here introduce you to a particular kind of masculine culture, which you would say is part of a subaltern sexual masculine culture, in terms of who reads them, what do people read into it. Now, one of the things I mentioned earlier was the films of 1950s, 60s, 70s. Okay, so there are different kinds of women who are represented in these booklets, on covers as well as inside. A very significant model of the woman that continues to be represented in these booklets, and that allows me to go back to my example, 1940s and 50s, is a particular model that helps to shore up contemporary masculinity. That model that I could refer to here as Helenness. Do you know that Helen? You don't know Helen because the idea of the vamp has disappeared from Indian cinema, right? The things that a so-called vamp could do earlier, a heroine can do now. Yeah. So that's, it's not surprising. Many of you may not have heard of Helen, because the idea of Helenness itself has disappeared. Yeah. Helenness, I want to here refer to as the representation of a particular kind of woman that you want, but also you don't want. So that first opening shot from the film Dawn, right, when he looks at her shoes. So Helen is that woman that you always have as your girlfriend, but she can never be your wife. Okay. Helen must also always die, or she must be reformed in some way. Usually she has to die. So in these particular booklets that circulate among subaltern populations, and not only these booklets, but there's a really famous writer of detective novels in Hindi called Ved Prakash Sharma. He writes about 10 novels per month. Right? And one of the most, he's the most popular, much more popular than Chetan Bhagat or whatever. So one of the most significant presences in his novels is this Helen woman, the woman who is the object of the double bind, wanting and not wanting. Okay. So, and what does this mean in terms of the kind of material referring to here? What does it mean in terms of the kinds of cultures of masculinity and sexuality that are part of this world of footpath pornography? Okay. So, let me give you an example from one particular short story of what I mean by Helenness, sexuality, and masculinity in the contemporary period, which is also linked to the political economy of work. The kinds of work that people do, the labor that they do, the worlds in which they live. Sexuality and masculinity of themselves are not particularly interesting to me as a sociologist, unless you're able to link them to the larger political economy of the society in which you live, right? Because your object should always be, I did my MA in economics, my object in sense has always been, when I did economics, I thought that it's not possible for anyone to know anything of the world unless you did economics. Right? Unless you're able to quantify things, how can you possibly understand the world? Right? So when I was doing my MA in economics at Delhi School, it was very common that that if you wanted to, that it was men from economics who married women from sociology, because they were marrying down. No man from sociology could ever dare to marry up and marry a woman from economics. I'm only joking, but that's also partly true, actually. Okay, so let me now go back to this. What I'm trying to say to you is that, it is important to think about sexuality and masculinity in these other kinds of contexts. If only to make your own, if you're interested in further research and thinking about it, more interesting. Let me give an example of Helenness in order to conclude this part of the discussion in terms of sexuality and masculinity before concluding with the immediate present with a particular example of masculinity that you will perhaps be much more familiar with. This particular story is from this book called, it's not here, it's a book called Raat Ki Rani Digest, The Queen of the Night Digest, right? And it's about Tejinder, who's a hard-working, wealthy Sikh young man who has an electronics business in a place called Wazirpur, which is in Delhi, right? He falls in love with a with a Malayali woman called Shirley George in this particular story. Shirley is a modern persona is established for a number of ways. She's Christian. She lives alone in South Delhi locality. She's been seen riding pillion on a motorcycle near the Army Officers Club in the cantonment area of Delhi's Dholakwan. It's important, when you're reading text, it's important to understand what it means to be riding, not side saddle, but riding with both feet astride on a motorcycle. Okay? And that's what Shirley does. Okay, so she sits astride, not side saddle, with an unrelated male. She's dangerous and desirable in some undefinable manner in this particular story. Tejinder is, through his sickness, the epitome of the martial masculinity that I referred to earlier, right in the start, okay? So you have this kind of the mise-en-scene setting of a particular scene, yeah? Tejinder and Shirley, when they meet, they launch up a relationship, they go to many car rides, Shirley shares the front seat with her arms around her boyfriend. There are frequent overnight stays in hotels where the lovers share passionate sex, whiskey, and that persistent symbol of Indian modernist diet, which is omelets. I don't know if it is the most significant. When I was growing up, to be kind of, if you really wanted to, that was the only thing that was available, right? And if you really wanted to represent yourself as eating the West, you ate omelets. Yeah? That was easily available. Huh? So Shirley's modernity is of an unremediable sort. It is very deep modernity because it is deeply ingested through food. She eats omelets and she drinks whiskey. And as an anthropologist, I'm being serious about how one could try and understand ideas of modernity. Okay? So her modernity is now deeply lodged within her innards. It is not something just for show. The affair proceeds apace. There is Switzerland, etc. And then soon after, Shirley asked the Jinder for $5,000. And Tejinder, $8, right? Tejinder says, no, I don't have this money. She says that her father needs it because he's got some loan. Tejinder thinks that because she's done some wild shopping in European country and has run up a debt. But anyway, so she dumps him. One day, Tejinder runs into her at a five-star hotel, playing cards and drinking in the company of an army man, captain in the army. He asks her what became of her declarations of undying love, and she tells him basically to get lost. And then she files a case against him for rape. Tejinder is arrested by the police, accused of kidnap and rape. And despite the false allegations made by Shirley, the author tells us Tejinder's, despite the allegations being false, he received an extended jail sentence. And in the jail, the story concludes, he lost the best years of his youth and was also rid of the obsession of love. And that's the name of the story, I think, obsession of love, something like that. Okay. So Tejinder's story is not an unfamiliar one in this world of footpath modernity. It pits as if like a traditional pure Indian masculinity against the wiles of a well-tempered Western femininity, the Hellenness that I'm referring to. They're constantly warnings against a deep modernity of a certain kind of woman. Okay? Not the kind of woman who will go to work but also come back home. Right? But the deep modernity of a woman who only wants to go to work. Okay? Right? Now, the other thing it's important to remember is also the large numbers of world who read this kind of literature, who visit sex clinic, etc., are also men who've come from small towns, villages, where they were the centers of their family and the community. For them to come to the city, they enter the city at the bottom of the hierarchy. Okay? So for them, the presentations of certain kinds of masculinity and the threat to that masculinity in the city are particularly appealing. So you have a particular audience that has been removed because of the jobs in villages and so on, places like that, and has had to relocate to the city, but his masculinity is located at the bottom of the hierarchy. They have the worst kind of jobs. Even a middle class woman in the city is much more powerful than a poor man in the city. Yeah? Okay. So, in an age of also hyper-consumerism, the desire for the active and consumerist woman, such as Shirley, is also a desire to take part more intensively in the cultures of consumerism. Shirley's deep modernity is a site of an intense erotic charge as well as a threat. So you have erotics of modernity, is what I'm trying to say to you. How to consume modern sexuality and yet remain in control of one's masculinity? How to have, but also not have the modern woman? Okay, now this brings me finally to my final section, which hopefully kind of brings some of this back. I want to now link up some of these things with a section that is called Modi-masculinity, which will be more familiar to you. Yeah? Okay, so I'll end in about 5-7 minutes. So what I want to say to you is that, now you know in the last election, the idea of masculinity and then Modi was a very significant selling point in some campaign strategy. So I want to say to you that Modi masculinity, I've talked to you about the 5-year plan hero, which is about the territorialized masculinity. It is about the nation as the site of your attention. Okay? What I think Modi masculinity does is it combines both the territorialized nationalism of the 5-year plan hero, classic nationalism, as well as that of his consumerist antithesis, the opposite of that. That is, what Modi masculinity does is to present a kind of model of masculinity that presents the man both as powerful at home, but also someone who allows you access to the global world of consumerism. Let me just give you some points, okay? Now, you're all familiar with the manner in which Modi masculinity was played up, and you know, some of these ideas about the 56-inch chest, etc., are still form a very strong, significant part of his presentation as a strong political leader, right? So there were, you know, his leadership style was efficient, dynamic, potent, capable of overcoming policy paralysis that had apparently afflicted his predecessor. Ironically, if you think about it, that Modi's masculinity was counterposed to someone who, ironically, historically, comes from martial race. So there's something quite peculiar happening. And what was this peculiarity is something that I want to gesture at, right? He was counterposed to Manmohan Singh. And historically, we think of a Sikh as the classic. So he managed to portray Manmohan Singh as the so-called effeminate person. Okay? So I want to just briefly touch upon some of these aspects. Okay? So he was seen as against an effeminate Indian type, unable to strike hard at both external enemies, Pakistan and China, internal threats, terrorists, etc. And then there was the metonymic invocation of Modi's 56-inch chest. Yeah? And various media commentators also took it up. You know? So there's one fashion writer who wrote that if you can read nationalism in Modi's dressing, Obama's look is about accessible glamour, just as Kennedy's was about spirited decadence, etc., etc. Someone said, Modi's empire line, this kind of dressing, is most flattering to himself, of opulent turbans adorned with pearls and feathers, gold and chrome, a machismo swagger, and his self-proclaimed chappan chapis, 56-inch chest. And then the various other comments. Now, the political importance of Modi masculinity was recognized by his opponents who, rather than asking what masculinity is, who cast the criticism in terms of claims of real manhood. So in October 2013, one of the Congress government ministers told a Hindi newspaper that Modi could never become the prime minister and he had not married. Of course, he was married, not living his wife. And hence he lacked manhood. So people also started to talk about his manhood rather than necessarily questioning the idea of manhood itself. And then in February 2014, Salman Khurshid, the Congress politician, referred to him as impotent Napunsak because he couldn't stop the 2002 riot, right? So there was both in opposition to him as in support to him, the discourse of masculinity was building around Modi. So what is the appeal of this particular kind of masculinity, right? And this is what I want to suggest to you in concluding is that it is not, analysis such as this is not about kind of a unilinear sense of identity, gender, and sexuality. I think what Modi does is that he works with his idea of masculinity. In order to discuss this, let me introduce two very quick contexts. One I want to refer to as moral consumption. Moral consumption is a contemporary, I think, way in which many people who have come from backgrounds where all of us, like many of us, where consumption was seen as bad, negotiate the world of consumption by saying that consumption is not illegitimate, but you require appropriate participation in consumption. So you may, as a woman, be hyper-consumerist, but as long as you are also deeply religious, as long as you come home, look after the house, that kind of consumption is a moral consumption. So one particular context is the idea of moral consumption. The second idea I want to just quickly throw in here before concluding with Modi masculinity and its appeal is the idea of what I would refer to as post-nationalism. Post-nationalism is roughly what I'm thinking about is an idea where nationalism itself becomes a part of consumer cultures. So earlier, nationalism in the high period in India was very much about saving for the nation, right? You did not consume because that money has to go to industry, so-called commanding heights of the economy, right? Whereas in the contemporary period, post-nationalism is that discourse whereby the state is no longer seen as a body that cannot also associate with private capital, yeah? Public-private partnerships, okay, for example. So the two contexts in terms of which are the background to Modi masculinity is one is proper moral consumption, and one is this post-nationalism. I'll give you a quick example of moral consumption. I don't know if any of you have been to Akshardham Temple in Delhi. Yeah? Okay. That is a very significant site to moral consumption, where it is an absolute utopia of consumerist activity. There are these vegetarian restaurants that people wear like these baseball hats, Rishi Akshardham. There's this boat ride that you can take to 10,000 years of Indian Hindu civilization, which is actually built on the boat ride in Universal Studios, for example. Okay. There's massive 3D screens where you can watch the life of the founder called Swami Narayan. So, and there are robotic shows, etc. Okay. So, Akshardham on the one hand is about contemporary notions of being the proper consumer. Why? Because the same place is also a site where you can switch between consumer and also a religious person. Okay? So here, religiosity and consumerism are not completely separate things, and that's a different argument. But moral consumption you might think of as that civilizational debate about how to be a good consumer. No one does not want more fridges and cars. But there is an idea about what is it to be a good consumer in the Indian context. So I'll briefly throw that in. Now, Modi masculinity to me stands at the crossroad of post-nationalism and moral consumption. So it combines the continuing imperatives of long-standing power structures and relations of deference with a new political economy. So you have Modi masculinity kind of undermines, it's a counterpoint to the five-year plan hero. Five-year plan hero was not a consumer. Five-year plan hero was a nationalist, a territorial nationalism. Modi masculinity is about globalization also, but Modi masculinity in a sense offers the possibilities both of worldliness but also the promise that men might continue to maintain their hold on both the home and the world. So Modi masculinity offers both. So that's why, you know, it is not just traditional. While we think of 56-inch chess, etc., is something that has historically a very long valence in the Indian context about bodily masculinity. Its current representation, current appearance in contemporary cultural consumerism is quite different. Okay? Because what I think the appeal of Modi masculinity is that it offers the possibilities of both worldliness, being a global citizen, consumerism allows you to be part of the global world, but also a particular kind of masculinity that, because of its emphasis on family and caste networks and kin networks and religious belief, etc., also a kind of masculinity that allows you, the man, to continue to be powerful in the home. Because you have to remember, historically, one of the most significantly threatening figure in the Indian context is the woman who consumes. Why? Because consumption is expenditure upon oneself. And the consuming woman is not the sacrificing woman. So in a sense, what Modi masculinity does is negotiates these possibilities. By negotiate, I'm not saying he does it. I'm saying that how one might view, how one can understand it, right? He negotiates the possibility of both allowing men and women to be consumers, but that possibility of the man, and in principle, consumerism can be a threatening thing, right? Anyone can consume, which means you can spend on yourself, both men and women, But historically, in the Indian context, the discourse has been about the woman as the sacrificing mother, sacrificing sister. Okay. What Modi masculinity does is allows, because no one does not want consumerism, right? But it allows for access to the world, which on the face of it is threatening, simultaneously as it suggests that men can continue to have a hold on the home. Okay. Because of the emphasis on traditions and home and the idea of family net, etc. So in a post-industrial world, while both men and women are offered equal chances of becoming consumers, masculine anxieties over female consumption are in effect assuaged through Modi's strong masculinity. And you have to keep thinking concurrently about the switch, right? That he is both a strong masculine figure, but not the strong masculine figure that will not allow women to consume. That is, what kind of consumption then? A moral consumption. It's also a discourse about moral consumption. So I'm trying to bring together here the ideas of consumerism, an industrial society, masculinity. Okay. But I'm not saying this is kind of a, I'm saying that some of these ideas are older ideas that we find in the early part of the 20th century of the male territorialized hero. But also in Modi's case, a male hero who is not a territorialized hero. He's traveling overseas all the time. He wants India to have a link with the rest of the world. Okay. So he takes in the world, he takes part in the world of consumption while simultaneously in the world of tradition is not effaced, right? Not gotten rid of in terms of how Modi is represented. He's the advocate of moral consumption. Consumption is good as long as it is appropriate Indian cultural milieu. So this is not, I would say to you, one other term you may have come across, neoliberalism. Okay? It's not neoliberalism as we know it. Neoliberalism is quite often, and I'll conclude with this, is presented as the producing of a subject position that is enterprising, autonomous, beyond caste and kin networks. So we have here now, in this model of masculinity, and masculinity sexuality always linked, processes on the higher scale, on a macro scale, that you could identify as neoliberal, the rise of private capital, its relationship with the state, but not necessarily subjects who are neoliberal. Because subjects are still located within, in Modi's discourse, kinship, networks, family networks, religious networks. So Modi masculinity then is the possibility for men to offer access to the world, and if their access is to the woman, to women, young women, that's fine. But also a discourse about how one maintains, continues to maintain control of the home in a time of extraordinary rapid change. So in some of these ways, some of the older ideas about traditional masculinity come back, or tradition comes back to us in different kinds of ways. And I'll stop. Thank you.